Hi there folks, welcome back to my Global Digital School of Art, and this is part 4 of my little watercolour painting inspired by my granddaughter. So in order to give you a quick catch up, all I can do is show you a section from part 1. Part 2, and I'm about to start painting on part 4. Right, now on this final section I will be ticking away at the mouth and the eyes, and I'm still working on the hair as such. Now what I'm doing here is I'm counterbalancing everything against these eyes. So what I need to do now is I'm going to pull in a little bit tighter here because the eyes are very tight, and then I'll gradually do far less painting as I move away from the face, because I don't want something very hard out here which will stop you making that eye contact. So this is what we do when we look at a person: we make eye contact, and the rest tends to fade away a little bit, and obviously the eyes and the mouth. So I'm going to tick away here, strengthen the mouth just a little bit, bring the hair back in here, and be a little bit more selective with the flyaway hair, and fade out as I'm moving away. Right, now everything is as I left it on part 3, other than the fact that it's now dried out. So I'm now about to come back close to the actual cheek area, and as I said in even in the first part, I don't want a tight line just there. So look, I'm just going to put a little bit of water which had come fractionally over the cheek itself, and I will come back to that in a moment when it's damp. So meanwhile I was getting rid of the halo effect, and I'm going to very casually drop out using my umber, watered down, is a wash. So washy, I can't see it, so I'm strengthening that up a little bit. There we go. And I'm just taking that out into no man's land where I intend to have my card mount. That is very weak, so I'm going to come back just a little bit stronger. I want it washed out, but I don't want it invisible. There we go. Okay, right, now I have now got rid of that halo effect around there. Just about. And I will do the same on the other side. So look, I've just got some fresh water, making it damp. To the approximate areas I proposed painting to. And just removing some of the puddles. And then very casually move out to the edge. Look, I'm not making any great commitment here because I still don't know at this moment in time how far out I will actually go. is still, once again, very, very weak. Go get a little bit braver. That's better. Okay, it's a little bit stronger, but what I can actually do here is that I can just water it if I want to. Not that I want to. So, what have we got around here? Okay, we've got a big puddle there. I'll just knock that puddle back. Right, now, I know the hair needs to come down, but on the upper section, I want the hair to come out. Okay, right now, I'm back to this little area there alongside the cheek, and I want it deeper. So now I'm going in quite deep. In reality, look, I'm now counterbalancing that eye at the top there. Eye at the top there. Of course it's at the top. There we go. I've just come in round the actual face there. Now look, I've overrun it just a little tiny bit. But it doesn't matter. I could actually move it back, but it doesn't matter because I'm going to be coming back with shade there. That will be my gentle warm blue grey wash. But I'm going to come round the side of the head now. I've got an ear out there. Right now I'm gonna come back around that ear, get my head out of the way for a start. So look, I'm coming in quite close, taking it in and taking it away. Right, I don't want a hard edge, even there. So I've picked up a little bit of water and I'm going to soften it with that water. Because look, bear in mind, this is hair. I'm going to zoom this in a little closer now. So you can see what I'm doing there. So I'm bringing it in quite tight just there. And then I picked up a little bit of water. And I'm going to soften it down. Very subtle, these things, but they do make a difference. Right, I can now bring that to expose just a little bit of the ear. Could be a little bit stronger because I want to point out the fact that it is an ear and not just a highlight. Once again, look, I'm looking for a little bit of variety there. And I don't want that sharp, so I've picked up a little bit of water. Look, and I'm just removing that hard edge. I'll probably come back to that area when I'm ticking away. Right, let's zoom back, have a look at what I've got. There it is. Right, now what I'm going to be doing is I'm going to work just a little bit at the top here, and then I will drop into just a little bit of speed painting, and I will come back when there is something relevant. Now at the moment we've got something relevant here. I'm just looking at my monitor, I'm getting a little bit of dazzle on there. I'm not sure if the colour's right. Okay, look, I'm going to keep going. Now, I was saying in the part three about which hair was going to come over the top here. And the one which is going to come over the top will obviously have to have a little bit more highlight on it. So I will gain a little bit of highlight first, and I've decided that in this case I'm going to take this hair over the top of this one. So I'm just going to run a little bit of water over there, which will remove the paint, and then I can come back and tuck in just a little bit darker underneath. And in order to do that, I'm just hitting it now to lift that little bit of paint off. You can just about see it there. And I can do it again. There we go. Right, I'll just remove that little section there. I can then come back with just a tone or two down. So in other words, here we are here. And this is still a little bit wet. But there we are, look, I've managed to put this hair over the top now. Now these things, they are very subtle, look, and seeing as where it's dropped away into that little section there, I can in actual fact drop it across this section as well, very very faintly, to make it look as though it is coming out and it's going back up. There we go. And this section which is coming across the eye, I'm just going to pick it up and continue it across the eye there. Keeping it soft on one edge. I don't want it hard on both sides of that line, because this is not a piece of grass. This is a collection of hair. Right, now I've now got a similar sort of problem here. I've got this one going across here. So what I need to do now is to bring this one over the top of that one. And I will do that. Like so. Right, now that's brought that one, this one, over the top of that one there. I'm looking at that, that is very hard, but if that hair was making contact with that one, I would have the hard shadow, but it's not. So I'm going to soften it. So look, even though it appears to be a tangle of hair, here and there I will get quite selective with what I'm actually doing. So look, I've got a similar problem at the top here, and I want this hair, which is coming out across the eyes there. I'm going to bring it out from under this one, as though it looks as though it's springing out. First thing I need to do is to add on a little bit of fresh water in the areas I'm going to paint. I'm going to let that go, and then look, I'm going to bring it back to make it look as though it's coming out of the head and turning back in that section there. So I put on a little bit of water. I want to bring it. If I can't bring that from underneath, what I'll actually do is I'll come across that one there. I'm going to zoom in even closer if the camera will allow me to. I'm going to come across this one, and then wash this one back. So I'm so busy talking, I'm letting it dry off on me as I go. Look, I'm coming around. There we come, coming around. I'm going to stop talking for a moment because things are drying off on me a little bit. I've almost got a twist on this one. Right now, softening the edge there. Because I don't want necessarily to draw attention to this. Right now, I was saying about this one over the top. I'm now going to water that. And then bring it back over the top. Right, now I've now got the problem of this one, so I will do this one during my speed painting, but you'll know what it is, what I'm actually doing. Quite like that fuzzy little bit I've got on the end there. Not over happy with this. I like that bit on the end because that was just casual painting. So casual works. Right, I've stopped here and allowed it to dry and put my board across the other side of the room and had a look at it from a distance. And I can see that it's getting far, far too busy now. When you're up close, you start to enjoy the act of painting, but you need to get back, calm yourself down and look at it. And it's like spaghetti all over the place. So what I'm now going to do is I picked up a big brush and I'm going to start calming some of these areas down a little bit. Bigger blobs. Now look, I will need, look, I've already quietened that down. Now in order for this to work, because I'm using a big wash here, I'm going to have to lay my board down a little flatter. Not easy to do with the camera there, but you got to do what you got to do. And by that process, I've quietened it all down a little bit. I can always come back on top of that after I make another decision, because look, I can remove little bits off of there. But at the moment, look, it's all over the place. So quieten the whole thing down. There we go, that's better. I'm hanging around on that one too long, which look, you can see it's not working quite so well. All right, so I will go off and have a cup of tea, come back again. Decisions, decisions, decisions. That's the name of the game. So my decision is, go and have a cup of tea, Barry. Right, now I'm now back again, and that was the right decision, by the way. I really needed that cup of tea, but it also gave me a chance to look at what I'm doing. It was the right decision, and this is the problem of once you get in a bit too close with a little tiny brush, you start to fiddle and you're not looking at the overall painting. Now, having once again put it in the other room, looked at it from a distance, I can see there's a lot of weakness at this area there. And also here. So in order to strengthen that up, I'm going to come back with my big brush again. And look, I want a bit of loopy hair there, but I must bear in mind that it grows from somewhere on top of the head before it comes down and loops out. Once again, that may sound a little bit strange, but it doesn't grow, in her case, out of the ear. So I'm imagining it coming over, looping out and curling back in. That was a bit weak. Looping out and coming back in. And the same will apply at the top of the head. These little bits here will be growing from more or less off the front. But I need a little bit more strength over the back, so that will come from over the back area somewhere. So I've popped that in, and I'll come back and loop something over that. Then what I'm going to do, this little area down there, it looks as though she's got two ears lower down. So I need to knock that out. done. Okay, so it's like I say, all this you need to get back, look at the overall painting, because quite often this is the case, certainly when it comes to watercolour painting, less is more. Now, do I feel a bit daft about doing all that speed painting there, only to reject most of it? No, I don't, because it is important that you, in the same way as with my students, realise that I do not make all the correct decisions every time. So, if nothing else, that is still of value. Right, what I'm now going to do is, because look, I've got a lot of highlight in this area around here and here, so I'm going to ease in the face back into the hair using my pile wash of blue-grey, warm blue-grey. Another area I've just looked at. This area around there. It, look, it's very, very busy. So, while I'm here with my big brush, I'm just going to calm it off. There, that's better. It's not a really busy corner there now. Right, now, I'm just going to drop a little bit of fresh water. Oh, look, the hair is close to the head at that end and it's lifting away, so the shade will get softer, and I'm just plonking on a little bit of water where I propose to paint, and I'm not going to dab that off. It was not such a lot of water that I've got to dab it off, because I don't want to lift the colour off there. So I will just wait patiently. Right, now I've got my wash and I just tested it on the side of my paper. And look, I'm going to tip my board round to one side, because I don't want the wash to run out to this outer edge. So gravity will take it down. Okay, so here we go. Look, a soft wash. And I'm being very casual when I do this. Picked up some fresh water. And I'm just going to roll it back again. Don't want to disturb the eyelashes on there, but it does help to give me that little plumpy piece above her eye. I need to do the same on the ear. I'm just rolling this out from the eye there. And I'm now going to come down and strengthen the shading under the chin, just to bring the chin out a little bit. And I will put a little drop in there. These are the little tick-tick parts which you need to do as you're reaching the end of your painting. There's still quite a lot of white just there, and that is, I'm going to put some hair there, but just in case I've knocked out that little bit of white, of the t-shirt. Looking at the other side now, and I'm going to put just a little drop just there. Look, that ends the t-shirt there. Right, now I will leave that at an angle to dry off. Yes, I'm going to have to do that little section again, but I won't come out as far. This time I'm going to come halfway, and I'm also going to come in here, and this little area there where there's a little bit of hair gap before I come around here. So in order to do that section, I'm going to turn my board upside down. Fresh water again. And look, I'm playing the gravity game again here. I just plonk the wash on and let gravity paint it for me. Let me zoom this in close. There it is. I've dropped the gravity, the wash, just below the fresh water, by the way. Now look, it's dropping away down there, and the same will apply here. Pick up my fresh water and put fresh water on the top. And let that fresh water run down even deeper. Okay, going again. Water. Wait. Go again. Right, I did the ear also. I'm now about to go onto this side. Right, now it's already watered. So here we go. Rolling my brush. Right, now once again, back under that chin. I'm going to turn my board upside down. Letting gravity take that one away. You may have thought that was very fiddly what I was doing, but look, what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to get the shape of the head going round. Remember I was saying that I don't want it looked as though it's been cut out with a pair of scissors, and the only way I can do that and that is to drop it back into the hair, so it's not looking as though the hair is stuck on front or the face is stuck on front. So that's what I'm doing. I'm just easing everything back in. And yes, okay, look, it takes a little bit of time and a little bit of patience, but these are the professional touches one will normally get. Having said that, I've just looked at my monitor and I noticed that's a little bit iffy just there, so I'll just ease that in. I'm not going to make big thing out of it because I'll end up by taking the paint off of there. So I'm now going to move in and just tighten that mouth up a little bit. Right, now I'm now back with the same wash, but a little stronger. Needs to be a little stronger still. A little bit too strong. That's a water it off a little. There we go. No harm done. Then I'm gonna come out to the edge. Remember, there's no colour there on that top lip now. So I've just brought it round. Look, there's the colour end. I'll do the same with the other end. That just gives that little gentle smile. It's alright, don't worry, I'm not going to break into song with Mona Lisa. There we go. And also, inside the mouth, just there. So I'm just checking to see that my head is out of the way. Because bearing in mind that tongue is a rounded tongue. Okay, let it dry off a little bit. I might just come back and tick on that. Let's see what I've got. There we are. Oh, look. Got a little gentle smile there now. Now, re-looking at these two, the left and right hand corners, I quite like the mottled effect, but they're starting to mirror image with the shoulders and this area there. And what I'm thinking of doing now is deepening my tones and sharpening that one just a little bit in the area there before I put the hair over there, and possibly come up a little bit darker up on this left hand side. What I'm showing you there, or here, is approximately the sort of area I visualise that my card mount is going to go on. Right, now I've mixed up my wash once again, and this time I've added just a little bit more crimson into the mix. So let's see what's going to happen here. And I'm working on dry, by the way. Little less mottled now, because although I've changed the tone, I also need to change okay, look, I'm leaving a little bit of mottled now, but I need to change the texture just a tag. Right, I've just picked up a little bit more water as I move up. That's going to help to counterbalance some of this heavy hair there, by the way. Hopefully. I love that word, hopefully. If something's worrying you, you've got a choice. You can either leave it alone or do something. And if you do something, you're running a risk. But you'll always learn a little more. Okay, right, now look. See what I've got. Look, I've changed the balance between these two areas there. But I don't want the illusion that that went behind the little girl and came out. Something happened behind. So I'm going to add a little tag here, just to counterbalance it. Not a lot, because if I do, I'm back to that mirror imaging situation again. Right, I think that will work. Look, I know that it's a little bit sort of mottled here, and I've got a lot of mottled hair, but look, I do have some clear areas. And this deeper tone has, in actual fact, I've just looked at it, helped to counterbalance the eyes yet again. So I think that might have been the right decision. Time will tell. Right, now I'm jumping around a little bit here because I've reached that sort of stage. And look, what I will actually do, look, I quite like that little plain area there and the little one down the bottom. I'm now looking back at the hair, and this area there is still a little bit jumbled, so I'm going to put a little plain area in there. In actual fact, tone wise, this and the hair, there's not a lot of difference in tone there. So what I do when I'm doing something like this, I put my finger in the way and look at the overall picture, and then I move my finger out the way. And if I'm a little bit disappointed with what I see, then I know there's something wrong with it. And the other thing is, I will stop and place this in another room to get a look at it, away from the area I'm actually painting. I'm going to have to tip that back because I put on a little bit too much. And that this was on dry, by the way, because if it's wet, all you do is keep dragging it up all the time. So you have to make decisions all the time as to when you want to work wet and when you're going to go dry. So I was so careless, I overrun the cheek there just a little bit. Because, look, I'm working almost left-handed when I'm on this side, because I can't move over because of the camera. So I am at a slight disadvantage. Sounds like I'm making excuses. I'm not really into that. But look, I've just had a look at that little, while I've been talking to you, I've just looked at this little area there. This hair coming round there is starting to form like an earring coming off of there. So that's another area I will have to look at. Stop the chat, let that dry. By calming that little section down, it in actual fact helps a little bit more of the bounce at the top there, because once again, less is more. So I've made the right decision. What I'm about to do now is I'm going to go back and do just a little bit of speed painting in order to get just a little bit more work on the hair. And then I will come back and I will put the salt and pepper on this little painting. Right, now, look, I'm just going to zoom in very close. Look, see that little low light down there? That is the pepper, right? I will now put a little bit more pepper on, and then I'm going to come back with the salt. So I need to talk through this little section I'm about to do. I'll try not to get my head in the way. And doing something delicate and talking at the same time is not easy. So here is the get rid of that. Here is the pepper. Just test my brush first on the side. The little flyaway pieces. And look, it's very, very heavy just at that bottom area there where the wash dropped down. So I'm going to pick up off of that. There we go. And soften that round with a little bit of water. Right, don't play around with it. I need another section coming off of here, or I can actually take that one round there. I'm going to bring another little tiny section off, bearing in mind that less is more, but nevertheless, there we go. And I will do that as well. I will take that one round. Right, now I want to, while I'm doing this, it's always hard just sitting there watching paint, not just dry, but paint going on. Just a little chat here. When you come to do your portraits, and I'm now talking from the experience of being with students for many years, and I get situations where a student is full of enthusiasm, and then they come in and they're very depressed because they've been trying to do a portrait. And someone, it could be a friend or a member of the family, they come up and say, "What's that? Is that supposed to be Uncle Jack?" And they say yes, and they turn around and say, "Looks nothing like him." Well, that I find very, very upsetting. Because what they're actually saying is, "I know better than you." Now, that can't be right, because in reality, the very fact that they said, "Is that Uncle Jack?" Oh, I've dropped a piece of water on there. I'm going to have to tip my board back. Don't want it to go wrong right at the last moment here, do we? I was saying. So really, all what they can do is give the piece of paper or the painting over to that person and say, "Oh, can you help me out here? If you know more about his nose than I do, can you do it for me?" That will normally bring them to a standstill. So, oh, I'm tipping that around. Because all of a sudden they realise they don't really know what they're talking about. So, when you come across this situation when you're doing something, while I'm talking now and just waiting for that, I've just picked up a little bit of blue wash, by the way, because I want to push that ear back. It's too bright. So here we go. Push that in. So it's, I don't want it to jump forward on the face. That's why I've got to push it back a bit. So when you come to do your portraits, don't call them portraits. Do what I'm doing here. It is a painting inspired by my granddaughter. And I've had a situation, and I'm talking about seriously very talented painters who've taken up commissions in their early days. And one of them was getting very, very depressed because every time she took this little painting for the chap to have a look at, he was a surgeon, by the way, not that that's relevant, but he was not really very happy with it. And I looked at it and it was a lovely bit of work. But really what it was not his impression of his granddaughter. And he was using this student in order to try and paint his impression of what his daughter, granddaughter should be. And you can't do that because it can only be your impression of that person. And you need to make that quite clear to people when you first get started, because in this particular case, this is my impression of my granddaughter. It is not necessarily her mother's impression, her father's impression. It can't be. Or even the child herself. It can only be within the skills you've got, how you feel about that particular Uncle Jack, granddaughter, or whoever. Right, now I'm going to have to stop because I can't move because of that little tiny puddle down there. Right now, it is now safe to go back into this watercolour. And what I'm about to do is I'm going to put on one or two little tiny flyaway hairs. Let me get myself comfortable for a start. Because that is the nature of hair, and that's what hair tends to do. It is a very gentle wash, but I'll just touch it down on the corner of my paper to make sure it doesn't flood. Now, they're hardly visible, but nevertheless, they do tend to put the hair back on the head, so it's not cut out. Now, when you only need two or three of these, by the way. There they are. Because that is what hair tends to do. It tends to fly away. Well, you've noticed that on my video. So unless this, unless we put gel on her, this is what will happen. So, look, we're not drawing any attention to these, by the way. Because sometimes the fact that you don't see them, you will sense that they are there. I'm just going to put another little wash on that section there, because it looks like a hole. Okay, I think that's enough. If not, I'll just come back and do that again. Okay, right, I'm now looking at the eyes. And they are just a little bit cold. So I've just mixed up a little wash with a little bit of sienna in it. And I'm just going to touch that down. There it is, you can see it. Look, it's like a little filter. Let me zoom that in close, if the camera will let me. There it is. It's like a little filter. Now look, if you, or the other eye's not too bad anyway. But nevertheless, no, I don't have to touch that one. Okay, let's zoom back again. I'm going to let that dry, and then we're going to put that little bit of sparkle in her eye. I will strengthen up just a little bit along that lower lip as well. Right, now this has been a rather long tutorial and I need to wrap it up. But it is the sort of thing you're not going to get, actually, if you go to an art class or an art school. There we go, I like that little one over there. Okay, let that dry off, come back and put a little sparkle in her eye. Right, now, on my brush here, I've got a little bit of Chinese white. Now look, when you do that, make sure that there's no blob of water near the hilt of that brush. And just test it down on your piece of paper on the side before you attempt this. And look, I'm going to now go in with that little bit of sparkle in her eye. There we go. And I wasn't sure about this one because I wasn't sure where the hair was going to go, but it's clear. So make sure it's in the same position. Now look, if that goes a little bit wrong, and it can do because there's a lot of pressure on you at that moment in time, do not panic. Let it dry. You know how to lift it off. Put the pupil back, let it dry, and do it again. Right, now let's zoom this back, see what we've got. There we are, look, there's a little sparkle there. And I've just strengthened that mouth up just a little tiny bit. Right, now, this video has been very long. Difficult to watch and listen to on occasions, but I've no doubt one or two of you have just been skipping your way through. But it is an opportunity for you to see and understand what goes into some of these paintings. And it's not the sort of thing you're going to necessarily manage to get when you're at an art class, because it is, as much as anything else, it is too long and too time consuming. It is very, very risky for the art tutor to go along this line. But we've got modern technology these days, so therefore one can do a video like I've done. But normally speaking, what I would normally do, because I'm doing sort of, six, eight classes a week, I can't keep doing the self-same thing and keeping up to scratch with each class. So what I would do is I will do something and I will do it up very much like this video, stage one, up flesh, two, and do it in four stages, and then just let the students have a look at it and we can have a few minutes chat about it and I can explain one or two items on there on how to get there. And that's about it, really. So where angels fear to tread, I have dared to go. Take from it that which you find helpful and chuck out the bits which are of no value to you. So, as I said, it is a very brave thing for any artist to do, even more for a tutor to actually do it live. But I've reached that stage in life where I don't mind a few errors, as long as the spirit of the thing is there, and that is what I want you to pick up, the spirit of the act of enjoyment of painting, and don't beat yourself up. Right, now I'm just going to pop a little frame around that. Right, now when I say frame, I'm talking about just a cut out piece of paper mount. I'm going to tip this up so that it's in favour of the camera. There we go. Right, now I can now look at it and make up my own mind about, look, there's one little bit which is worrying me a little bit. Look, that is nice and deep down there. It's still a little bit weak here, so I think I might just counterbalance that. But look, I've overpainted the areas, look, so that I can move my card mount around, or in this case paper, and decide where I want it to go. And I'm going to offset it slightly to one side. And more luck than judgment, this little sparkle there came about one third down and about one third in. So I'm happy with that. That seems to work. All I need to do now is to strengthen that area there. And I'm going to sign this, right, and put it in a frame for her. Now, it may well be that, well, I know it's a fact, people change very, very fast. So this stage of her life, it is a stage in her life. And the interesting thing is that when it comes to, and I'm going to use this word portraits, when you do a portrait, that in the long term becomes the actual person. So if you see a portrait of Queen Victoria or Queen Elizabeth or something like that, your image of that person is now what you see in the portrait. So this will, over time, actually become the image of her at this age. Okay. I will now need to make a decision about the card mount which I put round on the finished picture. And ideally, it would be blue. We would pick up from the blue down here. But she is, after all is said and done, a little girl. So I'm now thinking about picking up from the hair. And look, I've got a card mount here. It is just one I keep on the side. So that could work. It's not so overpowering that it overpowers her little face and it looks as though her face is actually looking through a window, because that is what a card mount does. If a card mount is dark, it means you're in a room looking out through a window and somebody is looking back. I've got another possibility here, and that is a blue one. In actual fact, I could cut the whole thing down and go portrait way, because I have broken a few rules here. By going landscape, normally landscape, you tend to, your eyes go from side to side. On a portrait or looking at a person, your eyes go up and down the actual person, like so. But yes, it's run me into one or two problems, so I would suggest that you go portrait way rather than a landscape way. And here's some more thoughts for you. I have actually used a good quality watercolour paper when I did this, whereas on all my sacrifice ones, I was using a stretched drawing paper. I call it cartridge paper, and for the Americans, when I'm talking about cartridge, because I have had this question come up, what I'm referring to, it is a term which we tend to use here over in the UK, but what it refers to is a good quality drawing paper. And in reality, if I wanted a photographic image here, I would not be on my watercolour paper, but I would have gone on a stretched cartridge paper to get an even less little knotty bits on the face. And I would have painted it in about 16 different layers, but what's the point? Look, I want this, at the end of the day, to look like a watercolour. And I'm talking about putting it in a frame, whereas with watercolours, that's never really a very wise thing to do, because you should, ideally, you should put them in a folder. But in this case, I have used a good quality paper. I've used artist quality watercolour paints on there to give this a little bit of longevity. So, but and it will last, providing it's not hung on a wall where the sun shines on the wall, because that is a total no-no for watercolours. So put it on a wall where the sun does not shine, or put it in a folder. And there is something quite nice about a folder, actually, because instead of you throwing the picture at somebody when they walk in, you invite them to look at into your folder, and that is an absolute privilege for them, because it is your own personal space. Right, now before I sign this off, because I've completed this video, but you know me, I never quite know when to stop. And what I want to do is I want to give you a little bit of troubleshooting, which may prove helpful to you. So if you bear with me, let's go for it. Before I get my brushes wet once again, look, I just want you to have a look at the size of this. Look, you see the size of it by the size of the actual pencil. When you come to do yours, I would suggest that you come up one half the size again, to give yourself a chance on the actual eyes. And what I've been showing you here is a process, right? Hopefully you select a picture of your own choice and paint that picture using this process. But if you do decide you want to do this in the same way as I have, what you can actually do is you can put your screen on freeze, take a little tracing off of it, and then you can follow the same brushstroke for brushstroke. But if you do, you will get disappointed, because I cannot copy another person's work brushstroke for brushstroke. I can paint within their style, but to do a copy is only a learning process. You really need to get onto an original. And when I'm talking about an original, when you come to do an original, be prepared to make some sacrifices, because at the end of the day, yes, okay, we want the image of the person or the spirit of the person, but whether or not she's got one hair across there, three hairs across there, or whether or not she's just washed her hair and pulled it back, it is still her, right? So you need to make a few sacrifices, because a portrait is very interesting to the person who knows the person, but not necessarily for a person who doesn't know the person. So you have to create a little bit more interest within the portrait to make the painting more interesting, so that regardless if the person can identify the person in the portrait, it is still a very interesting painting to actually look at. I have now got one of my sacrifice dry ones up here, just to show you what I'm talking about. And I'm going to zoom this in fairly closely once again, so you can see what I'm actually talking about. And I'm talking about this little flyaway hair here. And look, I've got a watercolour pencil, and I can pop those on. I've got too many on there, but I can pop them on using my umber one, or if I prefer, I can use my ochre one. And in reality, I'm really getting a better effect by this process than what I did when I used my brush. You just heard the brush tinking in the water there. And look, once I've done that, I won't scrub them. I'll just lay the water on. Lay it flat and let them fuse in. So that could solve one or two of your problems. Right, now I've come back this time with my little brush with just a little bit of Chinese white on it, and I've mixed it with the ochre to take the brilliance of the whiteness off of it. And look, I can get a highlight like so. Now look, it looks a little bit bright, but as it dries, it will in actual fact fade down. I've just come back with a little bit of water on there and just knocked a little bit of the board edge off of it. Now look, don't use white because you will be in competition with that little tiny spot at the top there. And if you do this, only use two or three of them. In other words, look at where you want to paint, select them, then go for it. So let's just suppose, I don't want one here, but just supposing I do. Oh, there's an awful lot of water on that. But look, that will dry back. But nevertheless, I'm still going to water it in. But you can see, look, on this one, it's so bright that it's it's counterbalancing that white over there. So that is why you need to put in that little tiny bit of ochre in there. I've now picked up a yellow watercolour pencil, but as you know from my video, preferably I would rather water the area down where I want to highlight, like so, wait and lift it off, because that does work. But it's possible that you may want to bring up a little bit more of a highlight. And so what I can actually do, and this is dry by the way, I'm running dry watercolour pencil over the area. Now, this is one of these other things which you won't see going on sometimes, but artists do that. And then they will drop water back over the actual top. So that is another way of actually picking up a highlight. And look, I've even got a white one here, so I could get a highlight on the end there. But I don't want to come into competition with the eyes. So that's why I'm using a yellow one. And then I'll just water that off. It's so subtle, I've lost it. Look, it will come back when it dries, or you can actually put it on when it's wet. There we go. Can you see it? No, I'm going to need to come up again. There it is. Right, just there. And you may find watching some of my videos a little odd, because I tend to go drifting off every now and again. It is an old habit of mine when I'm working with live students, and I'm talking about, you know, so there can be 20 of them there. Not all of them can see what I'm doing, and understandably, one or two of them will start drifting off. So that is when I tend to come back with some of my rubbishy stories. As an attention keeper. So talking about some of my rubbishy stories, you haven't had one in this video, so look, here we go. Look, being a miniaturist, which I am, not necessarily a miniaturist painter, but a miniature sculptor, and watercolours, in the past have played very, very important roles within our history. And I'm talking about miniatures now, because they're very, very much underrated these days. But in the past, they've brought countries, alliances together. And when one king of one country decides he wants to cement a relationship with another country rather than go to war with them, they tended to marry each other off. And look, this was the before the days of fast travel and internet and social networking and all that sort of stuff, Skype. So the only way they could make these arrangements is the court painter, a miniaturist painter, who used to paint pictures of the monarch on little tiny bits of paper, and they used to fold them up, no frames or mounts, they used to fold them up, and the monarch or the king would give these as favours to somebody in return for a favour they've done to the monarch. So all of a sudden, when they decide that they want to actually marry off their daughter in order to get this alliance, the court painter was then commissioned in order to do a portrait of his the monarch's darling little daughter. This was then sent off to the neighbouring king, or halfway around the world, and the king would look at it and turn around and say, yeah, I'll have some of that, right? As a result of which, they actually had proxy marriages, unseen. And of course, when the monarch, the father of the daughter, was talking to the miniature painter, he would turn around and say, could you just take a little bit off that ear or a little bit off the nose? And of course, the artist would do so. And as a result, when the young lady arrived and the king had been gazing at this little miniature, suddenly realised that when she walks in, she is a little bit older, right? And a little bit heavier set in the jaw. He was somewhat disappointed, but it was too late. The marriage had already occurred. So it brought the two countries together, but then the groom would then put the artist on a hit list. And there have been one or two artists who've been assassinated as a result of this. So when I was saying in my video number one, watercolouring can be a dangerous thing. Not so much these days, but way back in time, yes, I quite often I may say the artist had to do a runner because they weren't going to get the protection of the person who commissioned them to do it, because as far as they were concerned, it was job done. So the poor old artist was now out on his own, and some were assassinated before they even got a chance to spend the money, and others went into hiding. So as a result, a number of them could never paint again, just in case their work was recognised. So, what's that got to do with what I'm doing here? Not a lot, other than it is watercolour portraits. Do not underestimate them. Relax, enjoy, have fun, and thank you very much for giving the time to listen to this old boy waffling on. Bye-bye, folks.